Joan Agajanian Quinn is the former West Coast editor of Andy Warhol's Interview magazine and society editor of the Herald Examiner. Her cover stories are seen in Venice and Detour magazines, and she is a contributing editor to Angelus magazine. For the next half hour, Joan will bring you inside news and views on society, art, film, and the exhilarating worlds of these multifaceted people. Here is Joan Quinn.
Welcome to Joan Quinn, etc. Our guest today, John Philip Law, actor John Philip Law, and artist Steven Arnold, will be back as soon as we see my click page. This time, you're going to be going to the Callboard Theater in Los Angeles, where John Epperson plays Lipsinka. It's a one-man show, and you'll see all the stars that he played to on the stage. Watch the click page, and you'll see West Coasting with Lipsinka. John Philip Law is one of the most versatile and charismatic actors on the screen. Born in Hollywood to a beautiful actress, his career spans 30 years on stage and screen. He's worked an average of 2 projects a year. You probably didn't know that, John. I added everything up, and that's a lot of work. Are you a workaholic?
You figured that out. Oh, yeah. Well, I probably not as much as some of these folks who've done these television series and things. But my work's been, you know, from one country to another.
I know, but you've done stage, you've done movies, you've traveled all over. Where do you find time to come and see us?
Well, you catch me in my own hometown here. But, you know, I was born and raised here, and I just wanted to get out of town. Of all the pictures that I've done, I think only a handful of them were shot in Hollywood. Most of the U.S. films were shot on location someplace, and a lot of the ones that people remember are, speaking worldwide now, because I think my career is much more of a I'm thought of in Europe as an international actor, and even in America I found out they think of me as an international actor rather than a local, so.
Well, you've played so many roles. You've played hippies, priests, crooks, let's see, what else can we, you played a cowboy, you've played cowboys, Italian cowboys.
You're well, cowboys are fun because that kind of a set, you can take it easy and you don't have to worry about your sitting down and messing up your wardrobe and that kind of thing.
You're the famous angel in Barbarella with Jane Fonda.
Yes.
And you're the jungle explorer in Tarzan and the Ape Man with Bo Derek. Do you have a favorite role?
Well, my favorite role is the next one.
What's the next one? Oh, whatever's coming up.
yeah, really. I think that the nice thing about being an actor is being able to live about 100 lives in one lifetime and get into the, so say, getting into the pants of the part or getting into these characterizations. They are characterizations. I mean, we do get stuck as performers in our archetype to a great extent.
But you don't seem to have one. You seem to cover everything.
Well, I stretch. I stretch a lot more than the, most of the actors that you would imagine, that are in my, because they see me as the leading man because I'm a big, tall, cowboy-looking kind of a guy.
Yeah, great.
But I enjoy, for me, the whole reason I became an actor was to do other things. I feel like a character actor trapped in a leading man's body, you know, for a long time. But good character acting is, I mean, the good leading men were all good character actors, I think.
How do you define that character acting? Somebody asked me the other day, well, define character actors and I'll tell you
what it's the difference between a character actor and a personality. I mean, when I go to see I think that, you know, I've seen Clint Eastwood do wonderful character work. Films like Misty and Play Misty for Me and mm-hmm. Bronco Billy. I loved Bronco Billy, and I don't think it was as well received as I had hoped because he was doing a parody of himself, and he had become such an icon and such an archetype that I think his public kind of resented him.
That he did something different.
As if all of a sudden you take John Wayne and cast him as a car salesman or something. In this case, Clint was a shoe salesman, I believe.
Right. Well, how could you be an angel?
Nothing wrong with selling cars and shoes.
No, but how could you be an angel? Everyone thinks of you. I mean, I think that's the thing that comes out. You were saying, giving us a little anecdote earlier about a role in that Barbarella.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that was one of the fellows here was asking me about that. He said, what was that famous line? And I said, well, and it just as the Black Queen is about to rape me after decrucifying me, she says, and now you will make love to me. And I look at her and I say, an angel doesn't make love, an angel is love. And she says, then you're a dead duck. And she starts pulling my feathers out like
did
this.
Did she? Yeah. Should we show that? We'll show that picture.
Oh, yeah, there's Jane and I. That was quite a cross, a Salvador Dali kind of a cross that they had up there. That's the nice thing about, as an actor, you get to fulfill just about every fantasy that a man could dream about.
But this was one of your earliest movies.
Yes, I'd done a number of European films and a few other pictures. My first American one here was The Russians Are Coming, and when I did that one, golly, for about a year after that, I wasn't, you know, the phone wasn't ringing. I couldn't figure out. I thought I did a pretty good job, and I couldn't get a job. And it turned out that people started telling me, oh, everyone thought you were Russian.
They thought you
had a Russian accent. I mean, it's like I did my job a little bit too well in that case. You know what I mean?
Have you found your dream role yet?
You asked me about, well, I tell you, my dream role is always the next one, you know.
Oh, that's the dream role.
I've had a couple. I've had some dreamy dream roles, you know. We've all, and I've been on a roll, like every actor, you go on a roll. I've just been a survivor in this industry, I think, you know. And the idea of having a dream role or aspiring to a dream role that's what keeps you motivated. That's what keeps you going, because the wonderful thing about my job is that I'll never retire. I did a film a few years ago with Joseph Cotton over there in Italy, and there he was, you know, playing the old professor, and telling wonderful stories about the theater back in the 30s and things that happened, and here is a man who's done. To be thought of, I think, in my waning years as that kind of an actor. I don't, because Joseph Cotton, I never. I know he was a big star, but he wasn't what we call today a superstar, you know, or one of the big 10 or the top 20 or something like that. And there are an awful lot of very good actors and performers out there all around the world, not just in this country. I mean, I've had the wonderful pleasure and privilege of working with some of the greatest actors of, you know, post-war and pre-war Europe and Asia and every place else.
Because you started so early. But you've also worked a lot on stage. Do you prefer stage to film?
Well, the only place that you can really learn the craft of acting is on stage or perhaps in an acting school. I mean, an acting school can give you the tools with which to work if you get into trouble during your performance. And on the stage gives the opportunity to grow as an actor because you try something one night and within the framework of the play and what's going on, you know, after the thing's running a few weeks, you start to subtly shift things and you are in tune with audience response always on stage. You're just a heart breath away from what's going on two rows in front of you.
Is that why actors always want to get back on stage?
Well, that's the only place you can sharpen your tools and find out what you're doing, find out if you're doing something right or not. I mean, it's nice on a movie set when the cast and crew are an audience. And on a lot of the good sets that I've been on, it's that way.
Some
directors who hate that and don't have the time for that nonsense and all that, you know, here's your money, do the job, you know, hit your marks and go. But others that enjoy, you know, that kind of, or maybe, you know, probably people from theater and from other
can
walks
appreciate.
And not didn't just grow up here, you know, behind a camera or something. They encourage the crew to act as an audience. If it's okay with the actor, and then it's nice because then you kind of you get when you did something right or not. You always get that feeling, and you can do television, and some pictures just all day long, and you'd never know what kind of a reaction you're getting. I mean, they're cranking up the canned laughter, and everybody going aha. You might even think you're funny.
That's right. You might start believing it.
Yeah.
In 1965, when you did Norman Jewison's "The Russians Are Coming," it was supposedly your big break. Did you look at it as a turning point in your career?
Oh, for sure. It was turning point in my career.
Did you film it here or in Russia?
No, we shot that here. As a matter of fact, I believe recently it's been released in Russia, but we shot it in California, and we built sets that looked like Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard and that part of the world.
Oh, you did do it here because I know you're off to Russia. I was wondering what the comparison was from the 60s to now the 90s.
Well, I was in Moscow and Leningrad back in about right around 1970.
Oh, so you will have a point of which to know how far they've come or what they're doing there.
Oh, listen, I'm very much in touch with those countries in Eastern Europe, and being able to travel and work the way I have has given me a very eclectic philosophy, philosophically, politically, religious-wise, and everything else, because I find myself working in these countries. I spent 6 months in Bulgaria on a motion picture.
Oh, I've been there, too.
and that, you know, about, close to 20 years ago, maybe 15, 18 years ago. And I can't tell you how much it makes you appreciate this country. I mean, because, you know, the communism is a wonderful idea that doesn't work.
I was just going to say,
it's obvious. You know?
Do you talk about causes? Are you I've never
taken a great big soapbox. You know, I have a younger brother who was very much into causes, and he was Mr. Woodstock and Mr. This and Mr. That, and I think that as an artist and an actor, it's very fine to, you know, to take up something that you feel strongly about, but if you want to make that your life's work, that's one thing. An actor, I think it's very important to remain receptive to what's going on sociologically around you so that when the time comes that you're called upon to portray something that is this way or that way, you're able to draw upon everything that you know about that, but you don't necessarily mix your political convictions in with everything you're doing.
No, but that's interesting that you look at it as a
Screen Actors Guild, as you'll
recall, as a way to draw for your characters and for your performances. That's a different kind of approach than getting up on a soapbox and doing.
Yeah.
We'll be right back in a few minutes. We'll be back with John Philip Law, And we'll have photographer, artist Steven Arnold with us when we come back. Don't go away. Welcome back to Etc. Actor John Philip Law is with us, and we also have photographer, artist Steven Arnold. Steven was born in Berkeley and spent most of his years in school in the Bay Area. He was lucky enough to have a scholarship to the San Francisco Art Institute, where he obtained a bachelor's degree and a master's degree in fine arts. Steven is really known for his innovative photographs, imaginative, and I don't know what else to say, Stephen, but
mad,
welcome.
Maybe mad.
At one point you said you always wanted to be a painter, but here we are with photography as the main core of your existence.
Well, my photographs are more painterly than my paintings, I think. Somehow they cross over, and they come from drawings, and I plan them all first, so maybe they're the same. Yeah, I mean, they mean the same to me as paintings.
I understand as a child, in the attic of your home, you always were building your little puppet stages and little tableaus at a very early age.
My whole childhood I spent hiding in the attic, making puppets, building sets, making costumes and putting on shows. I was obsessed by puppets, and I never went out in the fresh air like a good boy should.
So you still have that pallid complexion.
Yeah, I still do.
I know you're working also now, you're making sculpture.
Sculpture and furniture and mirrors and some tables.
So you might be considered the Renaissance man of art or of jewelry.
Can we talk jewelry?
Where do most of these things come from? This is wonderful.
Well, I'm a student of comparative religions. I believe in all of them. And we've got Buddhism and Tibetan Buddhism and Chinese and Japanese and Jesus and Mary and everybody. I'm well protected.
Do those things show up in your photographs?
Absolutely.
I think we'll look at those later, but right now let's look at some of your sculpture, because I think that's the newest thing you've been doing.
Yeah.
If you watch the monitor, John, watch the monitor too, and we'll see a clip on Stephen. We saw some of the things you were talking about in there, the sculpture that looks like it came from all kinds of Eastern religions, also the masks that have to do with your puppetry, and you have some photographs with us today. The angels, let's see the angels. We had John's angel earlier.
Well, maybe this was inspired by John somehow. You see that? This is a new angel. This is Julian Latrobe. He's a wonderful painter, and I did his portrait as an angel. See, he has a palette and brushes.
It's wonderful.
That's a new one. These are just three crazy people listening to the sound of angels.
But the tableau, there's a tableau involved. How do you get your inspiration to build something like that?
Through my dreams and prayers. I have a telephone line direct to God, and he calls me and tells me what to do.
Does he also tell you where to get your models?
They come to me magically.
Do they?
Yeah, it's a miracle.
How can you find people to do these things? This one I know.
You know lovely Sarah Richardson.
Wonderful, yes.
This is very much like she is. but I've kind of made her into a goddess. I'm really into goddesses these days.
I know you love women.
I do.
I think you've been influenced all your life by women.
Absolutely, yeah. This may be the cover to my new book, which is coming out in August by 12 Trees Press, and it's going to be called Theophanies. And this man is thinking. Here's more clowns. I love clowns and masks.
Tell us where you shoot these.
I shoot everything at my studio. My camera's never seen the light of day.
And usually at what time? When do you
late
start?
Late at night. Only at night. Never in the morning.
Is that when the angels come out?
Oh, look, who's this? This river.
I didn't know you were going to surprise me with this.
I love this portrait of you, Joan. It's a triple exposure. And Joan's wearing a lot of her fabulous jewels.
And crosses. You
and
were
cross.
Very adamant about making sure all the crosses came.
I love that one of you. Let's see, what else have we got? This is the performance artist Rachel Rosenthal flying through space. And she's a very powerful woman.
That's beautiful.
And this is the actress Linda Carriage as Marilyn Monroe. It's not Madonna.
This is a little bit different. This is,
this is
I would
my
say,
first book.
Departure from what you're doing. What, you weren't into goddesses the way you were? On
I'm
this?
Getting more and more metaphysical, I think. In my newer work. This picture is from my very first book.
How many books have you written? Or actually not written, but
three.
And
I've
could you tell
three.
Us the names of the
My first book was Reliquaries by 12 Trees Press. And it's all photos.
And where did you get these names? Tell us the name, the Reliquaries.
Epiphanies, and the new one that comes out in August is Theophanies.
Where did you get these?
Inspired by, I guess, my telephone line to God.
Epiphanies, it's a healing.
Now this book is still available.
And the one from Japan, Stephen?
This one is called Angels of Night.
And you had a show in Japan, I know.
Yes.
And was it just photography?
Only photography.
Stephen, at your studio, I know you're always shooting and working very late at night, but sometime during the evening, you have salons. Tell us a little bit about it.
I gather artists and writers and interesting models together between about 6 and 8 for cocktails, and then I work after that.
Do you have any kind of an agenda?
No.
Or does it just...
The agenda is very painterly.
Is it?
Yeah.
Do you lead them off
day.
With something?
It's hard to get rid of them, actually. Sometimes I have to stand up and tell them I've got to get to work because people want to stay and stay.
Do they kind of straggle in one at a time or
usually? People call and say, are you having salon tonight?
That's how they find out.
That's how they find out. You have to come. You haven't been.
I know. I'm going to.
It's great.
I'll be there. In 1972, when you were just out of the Art Institute, you made a film that was shown at the San Francisco Film Festival. And I think you took it to Cannes.
Yeah.
And what happened in Cannes?
It won the New Directors Award.
And it won the New Directors Award, and it became quite an underground movie. It was called...
Luminous Procurus.
Luminous Procurus, and we have a very short clip from that. And then after we see the clip, you'll tell us what happened to
okay.
your film career.
All right.
Можно поближе. Да, ну не сразу, пожалуйста. Давайте еще поговорим.
Thank you.
when that film was finished, I took it to New York and showed it at the Whitney Museum of American Art. It did very well. And I had an opportunity to meet Dolly. He would hold court at the St. Regis Hotel, cocktail hour, every evening from 7 to 8. And you could go and meet him. And I took him stills from my film, and he said, oh, I want to see these. He showed the film, as it turned out, in the Grand Ballroom of the St. Regis Hotel. He invited 300 people. He'd never seen the film. Warhol was there. A lot of celebrities. Oh, his whole entourage. He loved the film. Gala was there, too. He loved the film. He kissed my hands. He kissed me. He said, we're friends. I love you. Come for dinner tomorrow night. He invited me to come to Spain for a summer and help him because he was building a museum. And it was going to open that summer. So I went and he put me up in a hotel. Just paid all my expenses. And I helped him decorate and embellish the museum before it opened, and then I was there for the opening.
I remember those times in New York when Dolly used to hold court at the St. Regis, so I was really excited to know that you were doing the same thing I was doing there.
Wasn't it fabulous?
Great. It was
you
really,
went then.
I did go, and it was kind of like just startling.
Yeah, it was so exciting.
Well, are you still making films?
Not at the moment. I'm working on my autobiography right now.
Do you think you have to reach a certain age before you can work on an autobiography?
No, I just felt it exploding out of me at this point. And it feels right.
Great. Thanks, Steven. John, do you have an autobiography in view?
I'm still working on that.
Your body of work.
It's been a very angelic day here in the City of the Angels. I know. I had to brought some more along.
I'm so glad you were here. We want to say hello to the composer of our theme song.
Yeah, Barbara Smith Reed was due to come and join us today, wasn't she?
We thought she'd be here with us, but she'll be with us. She'll be with us again. Thank you so much for coming.
Oh, thank you, Joan.
And thank you for being with us.
Nice to meet you, Steve.
Nice to meet you, John. See you again.
So, thanks.